Let's pray together. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the total sufficiency of Jesus Christ, the supply of your Spirit, the fellowship of other Jesus followers. We ask now that you would sit us down under the authority of your word, because we want to hear you speak. We pray as our Anglican brothers of old prayed, Lord, what we know not, teach us. What we have not, give us. And what we are not, make us. Do it for the sake of the kingdom and the glory of the High King. Amen. Delighted that you are here today and praising God. I asked my staff if they would want to continue the assembly for one more day. And they gave a resounding, not this time. But for the time that we have had, we have been delighted to serve you in the name of Jesus. And you have been a mutual blessing for us as well. So let's appreciatively applaud the Lord for all that has taken place these last 3 days. If you don't mind, I'd just like to teach a little bit tonight. Is that all right? Not preach. You had great preaching this week and great teaching, but I want to focus on just teaching this particular passage a little while. If I had to keep 10 chapters in the Bible, Acts 10 would be one of them. If you said cut out all the chapters in the Bible and we could only keep 10, then Acts 10 would be one of my chapters because it was such a cataclysmic shift to the next new frontier in which the gospel was now made available to all Gentiles. In fact, that's what I want to focus on tonight next. A divine thrust. Next, a divine thrust. Because Acts 10 is a cataclysmic collision of two worlds. You have Peter, the pious Jew, and you have Cornelius, the Roman-Italian company commander. You have Jews and Gentiles. You have Jerusalem and Caesarea. You have pagan faith and Jesus' faith. But it took a divine thrust to push or to move Peter, the leading apostle of his day. So I want to talk a little bit about next, a divine thrust, a cataclysmic shift. I want to read a letter that my son wrote me when he was 18 years old and an officer's candidate, the Naval Academy Prep School in Newport, Rhode Island. He wrote me this letter. He said, Dad, a man walked up to me, this is his first day, and he yelled at me at the top of his lungs, roll your quarters. I awkwardly chuckled, and I thought this is an inside joke I'm supposed to be aware of. He took my chuckle as disrespect, and he got so close to my face, I felt the heat of his breath and anxiety in his body as he yelled again, roll your quarters. At this point, I knew I was supposed to respond, but I didn't know how. And fortunately, another officer walked by and calmly explained to me that as I wait in line, I'm to stand in attention and walk on my hands closed as if I was holding a roll of quarters. I understood and stood erect like I was holding a roll of quarters in each hand. That first day was called indoc, short for indoctrination. I had no idea what I had gotten myself into. Discipline is demanded. My daily life is very structured. Everything and everybody is so sharp and precise. I take pride now in how quickly I can make a bed with every sheet and pillowcase stripped. I made a whole bed. I can make the whole thing with corners folded at 45 degree angles in 36 seconds. When his mama read that, he said, "I've been trying to teach you to do that all this." A good hot shower was 2 minutes at best. My uniform for the day had not one wrinkle or loose thread. My shoes were always shined. He said, "The level of respect for my superiors is unlike civilian life. You learn to identify an officer's ranking by their stripes. And there are certain people you salute and certain people you don't. It was hard to learn the difference. But it's the ultimate disrespect when someone inferior does not salute. So in the beginning, I just saluted all the time." One of the beautiful things about military life is the bond I formed with my classmates. The experience is so different from civilian life that allows me to bond easily with the next man or woman. I never felt alone. We were all struggling together. We walked in formation together in the snow for no reason together. When someone violated curfew, the entire class waited up all night, standing in attention in the hallway until he or she arrived, and we were all punished together. Failure did not exist, mediocrity was not accepted, and quitting is not even legal. I missed those things when I became a civilian again. I chose not to prolong my military career, but I will never forget the experience. In Acts chapter 10, there is a cataclysmic shift. So here's the sermon in a sentence. I didn't say the sermon would be a sentence. I said, here's the sermon in a sentence. Sometimes God the Holy Spirit must thrust us into his will, even against our will, to push us toward the next frontier of ministry. Let me say that again. Sometimes God the Father, or God the Holy Spirit, must thrust us into his will, even against our will, in order to push us toward the next frontier of ministry. I don't know what that is for you, but we'll learn a lot from Peter, who did not go willingly, but God the Father loved him enough to thrust him into the next frontier of ministry. I wonder, am I talking to somebody that God has had to thrust into the next frontier of ministry? Like Peter, you did not willingly go at first. When I was in the fifth grade, I was bused to an all-white school. The beginning of an integrating experience for us. About 8 or 9 African Americans were bused to Tidwell Elementary School in Houston, Texas. My mother protested and said, "He's not going to an all-white school." And she appealed to the administration. She lost. And they said, "Well, he can go back to Chatham Elementary, which was all black, and he had to repeat the fourth grade, or he can go to Tidwell and he will be in the fifth grade." And she said, "No, he's not going to repeat the fourth grade." And so I went to Tidwell Elementary. I'll never forget what my stepfather did. He set me down the night before school and he said, "Son, white people will never be your friend." He had a horrid experience in World War II as he served. And he said, "They'll never be your friend, so go to school, get your lesson, shut your mouth, and come home." And that's what I did. The problem was I met a man, a teacher named Joe Sorella. Joe Sorella contradicted everything that my stepfather said about what we called the other culture. Joe Sorella would come at my side, and he would kneel down beside my desk and say, "Rufus, you're a smart young man." He would grade my papers and write nice, encouraging notes in red ink. Joe Sorella would take all of the black kids, play soccer with them, kickball, and then his teaching mate, Tom Shipp, would take all the white kids, and before we knew it, before December came, we were all playing soccer together. Joe Sorella contradicted everything that my stepfather said about the other culture. Well, I was telling this story to a group of about 80 to 90 volunteers who were coming to our church in Houston to teach Vacation Bible School, and I was giving them this example that you don't have to be black to teach black children. You can just come, they'll sense that you love them, have compassion, that you love Jesus, and then you just teach them the Word of God. You don't have to identify with every experience that they've had. And I told them this story of Joe Sorella, how he made an impact in my own life, though he was from the other culture. And as I was getting ready to give the benediction and they were about to go into breakouts for training for various ages, a young lady stood up in the back of the auditorium. She said, "Pastor Smith, can I say something?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Joe Sorella was my daddy." I said, "Excuse me? Joe Sorella was my daddy. He was an engineer. He got tired of engineering. He deviated and became a teacher for 3 years. She took out her cell phone right there in the auditorium and called him and said, "Daddy, I'm at a church with a young man named Rufus Smith. He just spoke about you. Do you remember him?" And he said, "Yes, he was a quiet young man." And he was right about that. Joe Sorella, at the end of the year, said to me, "I want you to run for school president." I said, "Oh, no." She said, "Go across the hall and talk to Miss Whitmire." Went over to Miss Whitmire. She said, "Joe and I have been talking, and Mrs. Sorella, about, and you, we want you to run for president." I said, "No, ma'am, Miss Whitmire." She said, "Yes, you will run." You know, you had Miss Sokola, who's the principal, but Miss Whitmire ran the school. And so I complied. I had to run against friends that I developed then, Mark Kennedy and Jim McMullen, and we all had to give little speeches. I'm a beer joint boy, cafe, grandmother on both sides, so I went to get some candy. I got some pickles. I got some peanuts. And while I was giving my little speech, I passed them out. And for some strange reason, I won. Well, I said to this young lady, I said with tears in my eyes, "You have answered a 10-year prayer for me, because I've been praying and asking God to help me find Joe Sorella so that I could tell him thank you." Amen. There's a picture. Joe Sorella came to my house with his wife, Karen. And he brought this picture in the class of the fifth grade. And I don't know if you can see me. If they can't, don't you point me out. Sometimes my staff put arrows and point who I am. But I am up there. When Joe Sorella and his wife Karen came to my kids' house, they almost fainted. They thought that Joe Sorella was a figment of my imagination. And I used him as a teaching tool, but when they saw him in person, it made all the difference in the world. Joe Sorella contradicted everything that my daddy said of the other culture. And God used that integrated moment to thrust me into a new frontier. I didn't want to do it, but he pushed me, because sometimes God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, must thrust us, even against our will, into his will to push toward the next frontier, whatever that is. Several things about Peter, and I'll take my seat. First of all, the sovereign selection of Peter. The sovereign selection of Peter. Acts 10 says, "Now send messages to Joppa And summoned a man named Simon Peter. He's staying at the house of Simon, a tanner who lived by the seashore. Made sense. A tanner was someone who took the hides of dead animals and turned them into clothing and other things. You needed to be by water to do that. Peter was a fisherman, so these guys had a lot in common. But if I was God, it seems to me I would have chosen somebody else other than Peter in order to break open the gate of the gospel to the Gentiles. Because Peter was clearly prejudiced, stagnant, indifferent, and felt a sense of spiritual superiority than the Gentiles. But he was sovereignly selected despite his flaws and his fickleness. Now, don't be too hard on Peter, because you and I have been sovereignly selected despite our flaws and fickleness. If I was God, I would have chosen somebody else. I could have chosen a whole lot of people and better than Peter. But obviously, I'm not God. And he could have chosen someone other than us. Peter was sovereignly selected despite his flaws and his fickleness for this great task. Here's the second thing we learn about Peter. Peter had a clash with the Savior, the Savior's clash with Peter. It was almost like Paul on the Damascus Road when he saw this vision. The Savior clashed with Peter. The text says, the next day, as Cornelius' messengers were nearing the town, Peter went up on the roof to pray. It was about noon, and he was hungry. But while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. You're familiar with this story. He saw a sky open, something like a large sheet was let down by the four corners. And the sheet, there were all sorts of animals, reptiles, and birds. And then a voice said to him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat them." Peter said, "No, Lord, I have never eaten anything that our Jewish laws have declared impure and unclean." By the way, there is really no such thing as saying "no, Lord." I mean, if he's Lord, you really can't say no. So here we have Peter. It was as if Jesus had enough of his partial obedience. Yes, he knew about the Great Commission. And there were times when he, like in Acts chapter 8, he was on the edges of speaking to others. But he, for the most part, contained the gospel to those who were Jewish. And it was as if the Lord was saying, "Enough is enough, Peter." And he gave him this trance. He had a clash with the Savior. So Peter was sovereignly selected. The Savior clashed with Peter. Here's the third thing we learn, as we all know about Peter, the stubbornness of Peter. The stubbornness of Peter. Now, stubbornness is not always a bad thing, because once you convince someone stubborn, they are committed. It's not always a bad thing, but Peter was stubborn. But the voice spoke again, "Do not call something unclean if the Lord made it clean." The same vision was repeated not once, not twice, but three times. It seemed like Peter had to learn in threes, right? He said, "Lord, they may forsake you, but never me. I'll never forsake you." And he forsook him not once, not twice, but three times. And then when the women came and said he had risen from the dead, he didn't believe it, so he ran to the tomb and looked in himself, stubborn. And then when Jesus took him aside and said, "Peter, do you love me more than these?" He said that to Peter. Peter got upset because the Lord asked him not once, not twice, but three times. Seemed like he had to learn in threes. It's hard to leave the familiar, isn't it? It's hard to leave the familiar. I wonder, am I talking to somebody who God has had to thrust you by several times and not just one time? As we grow in our faith, maybe. But oftentimes, God has to do it multiple times. Peter was stubborn. It's not always a bad thing, because once you're convinced, you're committed. And he knew that. Here's the fourth thing about Peter, the short-sightedness of Peter. Peter was short-sighted, or he had a spiritual blind spot. I was talking to someone about blind spots, and they said, I can't see it. Duh. You may want to ask somebody. So Peter was very perplexed. What could the vision mean? Now we look in hindsight and say, Peter, how could you miss that? It's obvious what the Lord was trying to teach you, but we all have our own blind spots, don't we? And things that we should see clearly, God has to clash with us in order for us to see them. Peter was short-sighted. My wife and I, every once in a while, like 5 years or so, we let an outside counselor give us some direction. And we were with a gentleman in Pittsburgh sometime named Pastor Stu. And he was meeting with us in the evening, about 2-3 hours. And my wife said something, and Pastor Stu said, Pastor, did you hear her? I said, oh, I heard her. Then he looked at her and said, did he hear you? She said, no, he didn't hear me. I said, no, 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 I heard you. I can repeat what you said to me. And he said, Pastor, listen to her. She said you didn't hear her. I'm getting defensive and upset. What do you mean I didn't hear her? He said, this is what I want you to do. Don't do it when you get back. I want you to take your kids, at the time they were young teenagers, and I want you to ask them this question. What is the one thing you will want Daddy to change? Tell them it's no punishment, no recrimination. Just be honest and do it separately, not all together. And so I went back after a couple of weeks, and I asked my kids, what is the one thing you would want Daddy to change? And I'll be, if I wasn't in church, I'll be darned if all three of them said the same thing. Daddy, you don't listen to us. What? I couldn't believe it. But that's what Peter was. He didn't listen, and it took God a while. He had a blind spot. What's yours that's preventing you from being thrust into the next frontier that God has for you wherever you are in ministry? Here's the fifth one. The social seclusion of Peter, or social distance. Peter was in a bubble, in his Jewish bubble. Listen to what he said in Acts 10:28. Peter told them, you know it is against our laws for a Jewish man to enter a Gentile home like this or to associate with you. But God has shown me that I should no longer think of anyone as impure or unclean. Isn't that amazing? You know it is against our law. He didn't say it was against God's law. It was against our law, our cultural law. We just don't go to other people's homes who are not Jewish, and we certainly don't eat with them. But God has shown me something, that I should not consider any of his people made in the Imago Dei as impure or unclean. I remind us that every accepted social ritual or cultural norm is not a biblical norm. Every accepted social norm or cultural ritual is not a biblical norm. Notice Peter says it is against our Jewish laws, not God's laws. And sometimes we invert that. He was socially distant. When was the last time you ate in somebody else's home who didn't look like you, vote like you, eat like you, talk like you, speak like you? When was the last time you did that in the name of Christ? Well, in this fifth grade class, I met a young man by the name of Philip Lucia. I started to like Philip. We became friends, mindful that my dad said, you can't be friends. But I started getting close to Philip. And one day, Philip said, can you come spend the night at my house? I was very excited. I went home, told my mom. I said, Mama, Philip wants me to spend the night at his house. And she said, well, you got to talk to your daddy. He said, you better yet, let me talk to him. I said, okay. A week went by, 2 weeks went by. God is my witness. 3 weeks went by. I said, Mama, have you talked to him? He said, baby, I'm working on it. I'm working on it. I mean, it was like 6 weeks went by, and finally she said, okay, he said, you can come. From Friday, Miss Lucia would pick us up, bring me back home on Sunday. And this is what my dad said. He said, son, when you go to that person's house, white people don't eat like you. They don't sleep like you. They don't live like you. So I went home that Friday, and Miss Lucia cooked or baked some chicken, potatoes, and green beans. I had that before. But when I looked at the green beans and put my fork in it, it snapped. And when I cut in the chicken, it was a red stuff coming out of it. You know what came to my mind? My dad said, they don't eat like you. And I lied to Miss Lucia. I said, I don't. She said, Rufus, you're not eating. I said, no, man, my stomach hurt. I don't feel good. I didn't even eat. So we went to play, and it was time to go to sleep. We went to Philip's room, and I said, Where am I going to sleep? Because they had two rooms, one for his brother Vic and one for Philip. And I said, well, you got a room for Vic and Philip. I don't see but one bed in here. Where am I going to sleep? He said, well, Vic got his own room. I said, Vic has his own room? You stay in this room by yourself? He said, yeah. Now, we had a two-bedroom house. Five of us stayed in one room. And she brought out a pallet, a roll-away bed. One person in one room. You know what I said? What my daddy said. They don't sleep like you. Socially distant. Miss Lucia took us to a movie that Saturday. I didn't know what she was doing then. She took us to see 1001 Dalmatians. First time I heard of Cruella de Vil. Now, a little black kid didn't go to see that kind of movie. But she walked in with us and sat with us. I didn't know what she was doing. She was just being protective. Socially distant. When was the last time you went to somebody else's house? So Peter kept himself away until God thrust him to a new frontier. And then lastly, the submission of Peter. There's a whole lot of things we can say about Peter, but this is why God used him. He submitted himself to what God was doing. He resisted at first, and then he submitted. Acts 11. Soon the news reached the apostles and the other believers in Judea that the Gentiles had received the word of God. But when Peter arrived back in Jerusalem, the Jewish believers congratulated him. Did I misread that? No, they what? Criticized him. You entered the home of the Gentiles and even ate with them. Then Peter told them exactly what had happened. As I began to speak, Peter continued, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as he fell on us at the beginning. Then I thought of the Lord's words when he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And since God gave these Gentiles the same gift that he gave us when we believe in the Lord Jesus, who was I to stand in God's way? I almost feel like preaching. Because God thrusts us in a whole lot of areas against our will to pursue his will in order to bring us to a new frontier. And who am I to stand in God's way? When others heard this, they stopped objecting and began praising God. They said, we can see that God has also given the Gentiles the privilege of repenting of their sins and receiving eternal life. Peter was sovereignly selected, flaws and all. And when he saw what God was doing in his life and overcame his spiritual blind spot that we all have, he submitted himself to the sovereign Lord. And Peter finally learned it does not matter if you're black or white, yellow or brown, rich or poor, up or down, suburbanite, urbanite, ruralite, blue collar, white collar, Republican or Democrat, liberal, conservative, hawk or dove. If Jesus Christ is the center and circumference, the sum and substance and basis and boundary of all that we ever hope to be, we can have authentic unity. He finally submitted himself to that. I don't know what God is thrusting you for in whatever area. Peter wasn't perfect, but he did serve a perfect Savior. And despite his faults, his fickleness, and his flaws, God used him to kick open the gate so the gospel could flow to the Gentiles. Now, Paul and Barnabas was used to flood that gate, but it was Peter who was used to kick open that gate. People often ask me, how did you end up where you are? And I give them one answer, Jesus. Because like Peter, I'm not perfect, but I serve a perfect Savior. And there are a whole lot of people that ought to be where I am or ought to be where you are. My grandmama used to tell me, boy, don't you get the big head. Whenever God gives you a blessing and raises you up, don't you get the big head. Because there are people who are better by accident than you are on purpose. And only God can take a crooked stick and hit a straight lick. Don't you get beside yourself. So I close because I have hope in this broken world, this fallen world, our sinful human condition. I have hope because of one word and one word only, Jesus. I better pray because I get excited talking about him. Can I tell you who he is? He's sinless in his steps, silent in his suffering, sacrificed for our sins, and the shepherd of our souls, Jesus. He's the beauty that banishes my blemishes, sweetness that surmounts my sorrow, tranquility that transcends my trouble. That's the hope we have in a broken, fallen world. And why, like Peter, we should share this glorious gospel to a sinful, fallen condition. Tell them about Jesus, who was conceived in virginity and born in humility and wrapped in humanity. He lived 30 years in obscurity. He served selflessly, healed indiscriminately, taught tirelessly, prayed fervently, preached poignantly, suffered silently, died vicariously, rose victoriously. He returned very gloriously. Sometimes God the Holy Spirit must thrust us into his will against our will to propel us to the next new frontier. Where is he thrusting you? Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the life of Peter. We learned so many lessons from him. Thank you for sovereignly selecting Peter and clashing with Peter and showing us through Peter our short-sightedness, spiritual blind spots. Help us to take inventory of our life and see where we are blind to what you're trying to show us. Help us not to be socially secluded and dare to go into homes, neighborhoods, where others are who are not like us, to present them with the gospel in word and in deed. And thank you for Peter's submission. Now that the gospel is going out to all Gentiles through him, he kicked the door in. Paul and Barnabas flooded the gate. And may we continue to flood that gate. In the name of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, even Jesus, our Savior, we pray. Amen.